Dear God, I just thank you so much for who you are, Lord. Lord, I'm just excited to be able to hang out with these students, Lord, excited for this new series. And Lord, I'm just praying as we ask some questions, as we kind of dig into some things that even relate to where a lot of these students are in school, in their culture, in their communities. Lord, would you just give us a lot more clarity? And would you, over these next 3 or 4 weeks, Lord, give us, create a confidence in us that becomes life-changing. Lord, we love you so much. In your name, amen. It all started with a knock. It was a knock. In fact, it wasn't just a knock. It was like a special knock. And if you had the right special knock, then you would get let in. Now, when the door opened, there was still a guy that was trying to just measure and make sure you didn't look too suspicious. And then he would lead you directly downstairs to where eventually it gets darker and darker and darker as you're going down these stairs. And then there would be double doors down there. And as you get down to the bottom, those doors would now open up. And as you look in, it's so dark, but there's only one or two candle lights in there. And as you go in there, it's quiet, almost like you're preparing for something. And they'd go and they'd kind of stand around, whether they kneel down, whatever it was, they'd go in there. And as you were in there longer, the light would now fill the room and you could see. And when it was about the right time, worship would start filling this room. And they would be singing and they would be worshiping our Lord. Now this night, in the middle of worship, the things they'd been scared about their whole entire time is they don't hear a knock at a door. This time they hear banging, and eventually the door gets crashed open and they hear tons of footsteps coming down the stairs very aggressively and very loud. And when that double doors opens up, they know they're in trouble. They're immediately captured, they're immediately bound, they're immediately blindfolded, and they're carried off to no one knows what's going to happen. It's about 1, 2, 3 days. Honestly, they don't even know, because when you're blindfolded and you're in dark, the days kind of seem to go on. But when they're finally led out and they can kind of see through the blindfold some light, and when the blindfolds are finally taken off, they look all around, and what do they see? They're in the Colosseum, the Roman Colosseum, and it is filled with thousands and thousands of people, and there they are on the floor or of the stadium. And they hear over this guy yelling in the stadium, "Deny Christ and you will live, but if you do not today, you will die." And they're just finally like, they're just finally starting to get focus in their eyes. And again, he yells out, "Deny Christ and you will live, but if you don't, you will die today." And while they're standing there, one guy just steps forward and he says, "I will not deny Christ." And all of a sudden, it's almost like he rallied the guys behind him, because another guy steps forward. "No, Jesus Christ is God, our Lord and Savior." Another guy steps forward and says, "I'm not afraid to die today because I believe he is the Lord." And everyone steps forward. And so the proconsul that was yelling it out says, "You've made your decision, release the lions." And I want to tell you this story, that the lions came out and God had these angels around to protect them and they fully survived it. No, but that's not what happened this time. This time, every single one of them died for their faith. Now, see, I tell you that story and I go, why would they do that? Why would they be willing to give up their lives? You know, they could have lied. They could have crossed their fingers behind their backs. And I want you to know something. The reason they were willing to die is because they knew the truth. They knew the truth that there is a God, that he is Jesus, and that Jesus died on a cross for their sin and saved them. And they knew that, and they believed the truth. And it changed everything. You see, today I want to talk about truth. I want to talk about something called absolute truth. You see, you need to understand something. It's on your note sheets. Go ahead and click this. It's right here. It says, understand that there are things that are absolutely true for everyone. There are things called absolute truths, things that are true for everyone. That's what absolute truth means, is things that are true for everything. You know, we see absolute truths out there. We see absolute truths in math. Math, you know, 2 + 2 = 4. It can never be 3. It can never be 22. Yeah, it can never be something else. And you can go, I don't think I agree with that. I really think it's 2. And you're like, you're an idiot. Because if you take 2 apples over here and you take 2 apples over here and you put them together, it's always 4 apples. There are absolute truths in math. There are absolute truths in science, or the way that we observe things. I don't know if you would call science as actually observing and making decisions off that, but we know there's absolute truths in the universe. For instance, humans, we breathe in oxygen. That is a truth, okay? We know that we breathe out or exhale carbon dioxide. That is an absolute truth. You can't say, no, I think you're wrong. I think we breathe in hydrogen. No, like it's not true. You can say whatever you want, and there are absolute truths out there. And then there are absolute moral truths. That a lot of times you are in a world right now, you are in a society, you are in schools where you are learning from teachers and learning from our culture that there is not absolute moral truths. You probably heard this phrase, what's your truth? You know, my truth is this. Well, today I want to let you know something. You can't all have your own truth. It's impossible. Because if one of your truths today is my truth, is I think if you're not as good looking at me, I can kill you. And you're like, wow, that's harsh. It's my truth. And my truth might be like, I think I should love everyone. But isn't that weird? Is if there isn't something that's actually correct, that's dangerous. We can't all be right. It's impossible to be all right. There has to be an absolute moral truth. And I'm here to tell you there is. And we're going to talk about this. But our society is pushing away from it, saying, no, there isn't. You don't have the right to tell me if I'm right or wrong. And it's like, well, that doesn't make sense because we can't all be right. Especially if we all believe different things, someone has to be right. There has to be a absolute truth. And we're going to talk about why that is. But see, you're in a society right now where I think when it comes to religious truth, to moral truth, to the way we live our lives, we're so confused that some of you are like Amber. You see, Amber's a Christian who grew up in a Christian home, and she was interviewed on, hey, do you think it's a sin to have sex before marriage? And you know, if you grow up in a church, you go, yeah, well, she said, yeah, I believe that having sex before marriage is wrong for me, but not for everyone. And here's the thing is a lot of you would probably agree with Amber. Well, yeah, Trav, that's the truth. No, but here's the thing is if there is moral absolute truth, if there is things that are absolutely true for everyone, and that's what we're going to talk about today, if there really is, then guess what? It's either it is wrong for everyone or it's not. They can't both be right. And the problem is we're bombarded with this idea of truth, and a lot of times it is going to change the way you live your life. And if you do not understand it, if you can't hold on some absolute things, you will live a shaky life where you are just going to where everyone tells you what to do and what sounds better at the right time, and then you'll have nothing. And so today I want to make a claim that there are absolute truths. There are things that your teachers disagree, and I kind of want to say a bold statement, they're idiots. And here's why. This is totally a philosophy thing, but if you say, this is true for me, you just made an absolute statement. So if you're making an absolute statement, then there must be absolute truths. And so if you're making a statement that even says there are no absolute, even, this is crazy, a philosophy term, this is going to confuse you. But if you just made the phrase, there are no absolute moral truths, just saying that phrase, you just made an absolutely true statement. So you just contradicted yourself in one sentence. There has to be absolute truth. So we're going to talk about that. In fact, today I want to talk about what God wants you to know about truth today. And it's going to talk about, we're doing this series called Tried and True. We want to talk about truth and the tried part of, we want to put it to the test, and we're going to learn more about that. But let me just talk to you today about three things that God wants you to know about truth. The first thing is this, is I'm going to make a bold claim and say this. Number one, Christianity is the truth. Whoa, Trav, you're at church. Are you saying this is true for us because we believe in the Bible? And I'm going to say, no, I'm going to say it's true for the whole entire world. And here's the sad part, is if I'm making a claim that it is the truth for the whole world, I am now telling you that there are people in the world that are wrong. I am telling you right now that you're saying, Trav, this is the only right one? Oh, that's a bold statement. There have been wars around the world that are fought over what is the truth, and you're telling me this is the one? And here's what I'm going to say. Well, I'm not really saying that. Well, you just said it. No, you know who said it? Jesus Christ. See, if you have your Bibles, open up to John 14:6. This is John who is talking to his disciples, and he's hanging out, he's talking to them. He didn't write this. This wasn't written years later for the disciples to say, see, we're the only true one. This is Jesus talking before he died. He is claiming to be God. Can I take a step back real quick? Some of you like me, you think Trav's a nice guy. I hope a lot of you like Trav's a nice guy. There's nothing really done to like make us mad. He's a good guy. He cares about people. I like when he preaches because he preaches from the heart. I don't know whatever you think of me, but I bet you a lot of you think I'm a good person. But I want you to know something. If I started claiming that I was God and you still thought I was a good person, then you would be an idiot, because for me to claim to be God, I would be crazy. And yet Jesus says in John 14:6, listen to what he says. He says, you can click right there. He says, I am the way. This is Jesus talking. He said, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No man can come to the Father. So no man can go to heaven, can go to paradise, can go to nirvana, except through me. He makes a bold claim that he says, I am the only way. Guys, that's bold. I have people that go, wait, really? Jesus said that? Yes. When we're following Christ, we're actually saying that we think this is the only way, and it should start changing the way we live our lives. But guess what? That's not how it happens. You know what happens with us is we like to treat religion like ice cream, right? I don't know if you guys know that, but we like to treat our relation with God like ice cream a lot of times. For instance, how many of you, okay, who would be down for telling me your favorite ice cream? Come on, what's your favorite ice cream? Wait, say that again. Pumpkin spice is your favorite ice cream. All right. Yes. Mint chocolate chip. Yeah. Neapolitan. Chocolate. Chocolate. Grand Central Station. Ooh, that's good.
Pineapple.
Wow, interesting. Okay. Vanilla. Okay, so here's the thing is you're all wrong. Because the best flavor there is that 31 Flavors world-class chocolate is the best ice cream in the world. Now, I just said that, and you guys go, Trav, you're stupid because that's subjective. We can all choose our own, and that is the point. You are. And you know what's even funny is I don't get mad when you say that mint chip is the best one. I'm not like, no, that you are so wrong. Let's battle. We're like, in fact, a lot of times I'm like, heck yeah, because that means you're not going to eat my ice cream. But you know what's funny is that's how we treat our relationship with God. That's how we treat religion is we think, oh, I'm a Christian. You're a Muslim. You're good. Oh, you're a Buddhist. You're good. Oh, you're a Mormon. You're good. Because I'm a Christian. Hey, we can get along. This is awesome. There's even people that are like, hey, I'm a Christian and I'm a Buddhist. I kind of just mix them all. There's kind of this new age thing of like, you know, I take the best things from every religion and I make that my own. Here's the problem, is Jesus just said he is the only one. And if that is true, then everyone else is wrong. That is a bold, bold statement. It is crazy to think that maybe there is only one. In fact, I want you to know something right now. I am not a Christian. You're like, wait, Trev, you said, no, you know what I am? Is I'm a truth seeker. Did you know that we should be truth seekers that are trying to find the truth? But here's what I will tell you is, I've sought after the truth. I have done the brain debates. I have argued this and fought for it. And I'm telling you right now, Christianity is the only way. It is the truth. And you're like, but Trav, why should we believe you? You're making a claim. There's no one here that's a Muslim that can fight their side. There's no one from the other religions that can fight their side. How do we know it's the truth? Because you're claiming there's only one truth, and it's Christianity, and that Jesus Christ is the only way for everyone in the whole world. How do we know it's true? Well, that's the problem is we should test it. That's the second thing that God wants you to know. Test it. Guys, God says it's okay to test it. In Isaiah, it's on your note sheet. He says, come and reason with me. He's like, it's okay for us to sit there and reason things together. We can actually have an intellectual debate. Another verse in Isaiah, it's on your note sheet, 43:26. It says this, review the past for me. Let us argue the matter together. We have a God who says, listen, if you don't believe it, test it. Ask questions. Put it to the test. Guys, we have a God, the creator God, who created every single one of you, and there's evidence that supports that. If we want to do a whole thing on how is there really a God, we can do a philosophical debate, and I will have evidence after evidence that proves there has to be a God. And here's what's crazy is in the intellectual world, the philosophy majors, the most brilliant minds in the world, nobody can disprove there's a God. They can't. People don't understand. That doesn't get out. You are told if you go to a public school that you're an idiot, that you believe there's a God. Because it all happened by reason. But when you get to the philosophy realm, no one's been able to disprove there's a God. But I want you to know something. The God of this universe, he's not afraid of you asking questions. He's not afraid of you pushing back. If you want to go back to Genesis, God decided he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And Abraham goes, God, can we have a little debate here? Can we have a little debate here? What if there's some good people there? And him and God have a debate. Now, it is God, the creator of the universe. If he's like, I'm destroying it, you would think he would say, if Abraham said, God, I think you're wrong. Can we have a debate? He'd be like, that's it. Here's the debate. You're dead. Because he's the God of this universe. And I think we think that. No, we have a God who says, push back. Gideon, God told him to go do something. He's like, well, I'm worried that maybe it's not what you want me to do is the right thing. So he tests God. And God doesn't go, that's it. I'm going to kill you. No, he's like, all right. We have a God that loves us so much that he says, I am not afraid of your questions. I'm not afraid of your debates, because let's be honest with something. If something is true, if you say it's not, that doesn't matter because the truth will come out. You see, I have three kids. And if somebody here said, no, you don't have three kids, I'm not afraid of, okay, how do you know? You don't even know me. No, Trav, I know you. Like, don't believe Trav. He doesn't have three kids. Like, the truth is I have three kids. You can go to my, well, they're not at the house anymore because one's in this room and you can meet my daughter Emma right now. We can go to my house. My other two boys are at my house right now and they're going to be coming to service, I think, at 11. Like I can prove that even if they're not here, I'm not scared of the truth and our God is not scared of the truth. In fact, God wants us to actually test it because the way we are as humans, the way we think, that when we actually go and find out for ourselves and it comes back true, we believe more. There was a guy named Josh McDowell, and he was an atheist, hardcore atheist, believed there was no God. And he was hanging out in college with his buddies, and he had friends that were Christians, and they were trying to get him to go to church. And he's like, you know what? I don't want to go to church. Because there is no God. And they're like, well, yes, there is. And he's like, well, that's it. I'm smarter than all you. I'm going to prove it. So he decided to go, I'm going to prove to you guys there's no God. So Josh McDowell starts doing all this research because he's going to prove there's no God. So he starts first saying, I'm going to check to see this Bible. Is it really reliable? How do we know? Because this is really the main thing that talks about there being a God. I'm going to question this. I'm going to go do the historical things, archaeological things. I'm going to go through those. I'm going to start questioning everything. He starts going on a historical, all this. And guess what? After months of trying to disprove God, he actually ends up discovering, he believes, he's like, oh my goodness, it is true. And he becomes a Christian and becomes one of the strongest Christians out there. The same thing happened with a guy that you might know the name, C.S. Lewis. In fact, here's what's crazy. You know, C.S. Lewis, people say that his IQ was actually higher than Albert Einstein's. And C.S. Lewis might have been the most brilliant mind this world had ever seen, and he went out to disprove there was a God and ended up believing there has to be a God, and this God has to be the God of this Bible, and it has to be Jesus Christ. You see, God's not afraid of us testing it. And I want to let you know something. If you guys are coming to church today because your parents bring you, and you're a Christian because your parents are Christians, or if you're Christians today because you're like, but Trav, you're so nice, and all the leaders in here, they're so good. We're Christians because of them. We need to test it. We need to test it on our own. Because you need more than just because we said so, because there's going to be a time in your life where life gets hard. And now you can't rely on, well, Travis said, my parents said, but you need to make it your own. So here's the thing is, once you've tested it and you've got, put it on maybe trial and decided, hey, is this really the truth? Then the third thing is this, it should turn your belief into a conviction. You see, here's the thing is, the third thing God wants you to know about truth is this, is once you've tested it, once you've tried to test it and tried to put it to test to go, is it really what it is? Is it really the truth? Then it should change something about you. You see, here's the thing is, a lot of you right now, you kind of believe it. You believe Jesus is God. You come to church because your parents say so, and it feels good right now, and it works for you right now. But here's the problem if it's not a conviction. See, a conviction is like those guys at the beginning of my talk, that they were willing to die, and even though they could have crossed their fingers on the back and said, no, we don't believe Jesus is God, and they're like, oh, Travis, you're safe. And you're like, ha, thanks. And you're like, forget you guys. I totally believe it's God. I was lying. The reason they didn't do that is because they knew the truth and it was a conviction. They said, we don't care because we believe the minute those lions eat me, I'm in heaven the next moment. In fact, if you truly believe this was the truth and it's the only way, then you would not care if you died. In fact, you would be like me, where when someone dies that I know is going to heaven, I'm actually mad, not because God killed them. I'm mad they beat me to heaven first, because this world sucks compared to heaven. I don't sleep a lot of nights. I'm stressed all the time. Life is hard on me. Yes, I love you guys, and I love my life, but yet it's still hard. There's still stresses. There's still things that eat me. There's still things where my heart races all night. Like, it would just be nice to be in heaven right now. So sometimes if we really believe that there is a God and there really is heaven, then death shouldn't scare us, because it's like, heck yeah, finally I get to go to heaven. Now I know this. You're like, well, Trav, why don't you make that happen? It's because I know that God still needs me here. I know that there's still a plan, that God's like, Trav, I need you, because there's some things I still need to help for the kingdom. I think he has a plan for you. That's why we don't try to help ourselves get there. But I won't lie. Like, I get jealous sometimes. People are like, dude, you're lucky. And if it really was a conviction in your life, it would change something. And here's why it's dangerous. You see, if Christianity is not a conviction in your life, here's what happens. If it's just a belief because you've been coming to church for the last 3 or 4 weeks or for the last 3 or 4 years, what happens when life sucks? What happens when someone in your family dies that you loved? What happens when your boyfriend or girlfriend breaks up to you and you thought they were the love of your life and you were going to be with them forever? What happens when your parents get a divorce? What happens when you lose, you're all of a sudden your parents are on the street and your family's because something happened drastically and now you have no money? What happens when you have no friends? And just keep going down the list. And if Christianity is just a belief, not a conviction, when that happens, you go, screw you, God. You must not be real. What happens when your teacher in college says you're an idiot if you're a Christian? You're a mindless idiot, which is funny because when I was in college, I wasn't smart enough to go, actually, you're an idiot. because there's more evidence. The leading atheist just about 7-8 years ago said there must be a God. The one who wrote all the atheist books that everyone has fallen if you're an atheist just came out and said there must be a God. Because of the evidence. But what happens when those things happen? If it's not a conviction, you say, peace out, God, maybe you're not real. In fact, almost all atheists were Christians at one time, but because of hurt, pain, loss, hypocrites, peace out, God. We want this to become a conviction, and not till you understand there, first of all, there is absolute truth. You understand that. Not till you put it to the test and you start saying, okay, God, I want to see if this is true for me. I want to make sure that I've had all my questions answered. And not till you say, okay, now I know it's the truth. I'm willing to die for it. Are you at a point where now you can start being someone who can start really being used by God? Now, listen, God can use you. I made a statement that's crazy. God can still use you whether you believe it or not, which is crazy because I have people that are non-Christians that still invited people to church, and those people became Christians, and that person never, crazy. But our faith needs to be strong enough where it becomes a conviction. So some of you are like, Trav, great little cool story, cool thing. Yeah, I don't disagree with you, but what now? Well, what if for the next few weeks we help you on this journey? Some of you don't even know the question to ask. What do you need to feel confident to know that this is the only way? We want to help you. We want to put this Bible and we want to say, is this really true? Because it says a lot of stuff in here. But if this was just made up 2 years ago or 200 years ago, well, then it's a bunch of crap. I shouldn't follow it. Well, let's find out. Is this what it says it is? Is Jesus really God? How do we know for sure Jesus is God? It says it in there, but is there any things that outside of the Bible, outside of Christianity, can help prove it? Yes. Is there actually some different kind of hardcore evidence that supports that Jesus was God, that the Bible is true? Yes. That's outside of the Bible? Yes. That we can pair together and create this picture, like, guess what? It has to be true. Where every other religion, there are so many holes that we can a lot of times debate it literally within minutes. Within minutes, there are so many holes they're done. This one can't be debated. It's one every time. So we want to help you. So for the next few weeks, tried and true, we are going to actually help you ask the questions. And my hope doesn't stop there. Just because we preached it, you should go home all the time. Is that really true? Do I really believe that? Trav, I have another question. Hey, Shara, Taylor, guys, is this true? Is this true? That's what we should do, because we should be on a truth-finding mission to find the truth. And that's what I want to put. We're going to try to do that in these next few weeks. And we're not scared of your questions. We're not scared of you pushing back. Because guess what? I'm not scared of the truth, because if it's the truth, I'm not scared. And that's what we're going to do the next few weeks. Let me go and pray. Dear God, I just thank you so much for who you are, Lord. Lord, I just pray as we talk about truth, Lord, that you would help these students. If they have questions, I don't know what they need for them to turn this belief into a conviction, Lord, but would you give them those questions? Lord, would there be stuff we talk about that solidifies, that gives them confidence, that they now go, I believe. And God, I'm sold out. I'm sold out. Lord, I love you so much. In your name, amen.